Hello everyone. In this video, I introduce the basic concepts of representation theory. It is mainly intended for those who is going to apply it in physics or chemistry. Some parts may be not fully rigorous, but the goal is to help you feel how it works and build some intuition. Feel free to point out any inaccuracies in comments. Let's start simple. Let's recall how graphs of some functions look in polar coordinates. We will need them later to illustrate what's happening. Here, the pink line corresponds to the positive sign of the function, and the blue line corresponds to the negative sign. The angle phi is measured from the x-axis in the following way. Now let's see how to write the transformation of a function of r, then we rotate it. We will denote the rotation by the letter r. Let's look at it using the example of the function sine phi. Notice that the value of the rotated function at some point k is equal to the value of the original function at the point k prime rotated by the opposite angle. This means that the rotated function f prime of r is written as the original function evaluated at the point rotated by the inverse angle. That's why we use r in power minus 1 here. Notice also that if we are in the xy plane, the coordinates of a point rotated by an angle alpha are simply given by the rotation matrix. Let's practice rotating some functions. For example, let's take the function f of r, let's say xy plus yx. Of course, we could notice that xy equals yx and simply write 2xy, but we will not do that so that later one can generalize it, for example, for the case of tensor products of functions. Rotating functions is very simple. We just substitute the expressions for x and y rotated by an angle alpha, meaning we express them using the rotation matrix. After expanding the brackets, we obtain the following expression. During the same procedure with the function x square minus y square, we get the following result. Notice that we have an interesting situation. These two functions, under an arbitrary rotation around the z-axis, transform simply into linear combinations of each other. This was not something that had to happen. We specifically chose these functions this way. Later it will become clear why. For now, let's write this transformation of the two functions in the form of a matrix. Notice that what we obtained looks suspiciously similar to a rotation matrix, except that instead of the angle alpha, we have the angle 2 alpha. In fact, the functions we took are just proportional to the Cartesian forms of the cosine of the double the angle and the sine of the double the angle, but for now it is not so important. Let's just keep this mysterious behavior in mind and move on the actual theory of group representations. Let's recall the definition of a group. A group is a set G equipped with a binary operation, that is, a multiplication operation which satisfies the following properties: associativity, the existence of a neutral element, the identity, and the existence of inverse element. We will not be interested in arbitrary groups here, but specifically in groups of symmetries of certain objects. For example, the symmetry group of a triangle called C3v in Schoenflies notation. It is also sometimes referred as D3 or S3. Don't be surprised if you encounter different names. An element of the group is an operation that maps the triangle onto itself, although it may change its coloring. There are 6 elements in this group. The identity elements mean that we do nothing to the triangle, we leave it as it is. A rotation by 120 degrees maps the triangle onto itself. a rotation by 240 degrees reflection across the vertical plane, and two more reflections across other planes are also elements of the group. Earlier, we discussed how functions behave under arbitrary rotations in plane. Now, let's look at how they behave under specific rotations of the triangle symmetry group, that is, under rotation by 120 degrees, and write down the corresponding rotation matrix. They look as follows. Here we notice something very interesting. If instead of those specific functions, we substitute just the functions x and y, the expressions, the matrices still remain valid. X and y under a 120 degree rotation transform in exactly the same way as 2xy and x square minus y square. This coincidence is not accidental. So, imagine we have a set of some functions, some bases, for example, a collection of sines, cosines, exponentials, or, for example, a collection of spherical functions. These functions should be actually good enough, in a sense. And under all rotations, reflections, and so on, they should be expressed in the linear combinations of each other. And it turns out that there are actually not so many ways in which they can behave under the transformations of a finite group. These cases are exactly what we are going to study now. We were speaking about rotations, but check that under reflections, the function xy plus yx and x square minus y square behave in exactly the same way also as x and y. As another example, let's look at how the functions of sine of triple angle and cosine of triple angle behave. Of course, we could rewrite them in Cartesian coordinates and perform the same substitution, replacing x and y with the rotated versions and so on, but it's much simpler to just look at the pictures and see what happens. For example, this function does not change at all under 100 degree rotation nor under 240 degree rotation. And the other function also essentially stays the same under these rotations. However, under reflection, they behave differently. For instance, if we reflect these functions across the vertical plane, it changes sign. The same happens then reflecting across the other two planes. On the other hand, the second function does not change its sign even under such reflections. It remains itself always under all possible transformation of triangle group. And we now want to write down the matrices of rotations and reflections for these functions, just as we did in the previous case. We will get very simple matrices. For example, under rotation by 120 or 240 degrees, nothing happens to these two functions. They are simply multiplied by 1. However, under reflection, the cosine function picks up a sine minus and then multiplied by minus 1. Notice that this behavior is related only to the way we have oriented the triangle. If we had placed the triangle differently, for instance, so that the reflection plane was the horizontal plane, the situation would be exactly the opposite. This function would then become odd and the other would become even. In general, it is more convenient to orient the triangle in this particular way, because then the sine function will always be odd and the cosine function will always be even, just as we used to. But in this particular video, we use different rotation. Here, we didn't really have to write 2x2 matrix. We could have just written 1x1 matrices and a row consisting of a single function, and everything would still work properly, because these matrices are just diagonal. It turns out that in the symmetry group of the triangle, there are only three distinct ways in which any set of basis functions can transform. Specifically, let's write down the transformation matrices for all three cases. Each row here lists six matrices corresponding to the six elements of the group. The first row corresponds to how the function sine 3 phi behaves assuming this particular orientation of the triangle. The second row corresponds to how cosine 3 phi behaves. Indeed, sine remains unchanged under all group operations, it is simply multiplied by 1. Meanwhile, cosine changes sine under reflections, meaning it is multiplied by minus 1. Here we also listed the rotation matrices that describe how functions like x and y transform, or functions like xy plus yx and x square minus y square, and actually many other. In fact, many more functions behave exactly in the same way, exactly in one of these three ways. For example, think about how cosine 0 phi would behave. Obviously, it is just a circle and does not change under any transformation. Or consider sine 6 phi and cosine 6 phi, or even sine 9 phi and so on. Or more complicated functions like sine 4 phi and cosine 4 phi, but in general every sine or cosine of n phi will behave in one of these three ways under transformations of the triangle symmetry group, alone or in pair. Of course, these functions do not have to be only sines and cosines in general, we are just using them here as convenient examples. In any other symmetry group, the multiplication operation is simply the sequential application of transformations. That is, for example, first rotating, then reflecting, and so on. Here we write down the multiplication table of this group. Note that the matrices that we write are also multiplied in the same way. Specifically, matrix D from G1 corresponding to an element G1 of the group multiplied by a matrix D of G2 corresponding to an element G2 will be simply equal to the matrix D of multiplication G1, G2. It turns out that these matrices are representations of the group. Or more precisely, a representation of a group is any set of matrices which satisfies this multiplication rule. Take, for example, the identity matrix of arbitrary size. Indeed, multiplying identity matrices always gives back the identity matrix, so it satisfies any multiplication table because nothing changes. So we could fill in every cell of the group multiplication table with identity matrices, even one by one, and it would be a valid representation. Similarly, we could fill the table with matrices where reflections correspond to minus ones and rotations correspond to ones. Rotation matrices 2 by 2 considered previously, of course, also fit. In fact, we can come up with many non-trivial matrices that still satisfy the multiplication table. Let's try to construct something non-trivial. If we think about it, any rotation on reflection of the triangle is in fact just a way of permuting its three points. For example, the colors at the vertices are simply swapped. If we arrange the coordinates of the three points into a row, treating them as a basis, and then write matrices that just rearrange these coordinates, we end up with matrices of a following form. This is called a permutation representation. At first, it looks very different from the matrices we discussed earlier. But we can find a single change of basis that simultaneously brings all six of these matrices into a new form, a block diagonal form, where the blocks include the rotation matrix we have already seen, along with the matrix filled entirely with ones, which we have also already seen. Again, matrix T is the same for all six elements. For the triangle symmetry group, it turns out that any representation, meaning any set of matrices that satisfy the group multiplication rules, can be brought into such a block diagonal form by an appropriate change of basis. For triangles, there are only three types of minimal blocks that can appear this way, and we have already seen them earlier. These minimal blocks are called irreducible representations of the group, and permutation representation we've seen above was, of course, reducible. What this tells us is that no matter which set of basis functions we pick and transform under the group, there's always a way, by changing the basis, to split everything into subspaces of either one or two dimensions, in case of triangle. All possible functions will behave either like x and y, or like cosine 3 phi or sine 3 phi. The first way is usually called invariant. The second type, which behaves like cosine here, can sometimes be called a pseudoscalar representation in slang. And you might also meet labels like A1, A2 and E for these types of representations. These are Mulliken symbols. A stricter definition of a group representation goes as follows. A representation of a group G is a gomomorphism D from the our group into the group of invertible linear transformations of a vector space V. Invertible linear transformations can be represented by matrices, and the homomorphism condition means that they respect the group multiplication structure, namely fit the multiplication table. However, a group cannot always be uniquely reconstructed from its representation. Indeed, from just identity matrices, we cannot say anything specific about the group itself, so it is not isomorphism. A representation is called irreducible if the space V contains no non-trivial invariant subspaces. In other words, one cannot further reduce the matrices to block diagonal form. The action of a group element on a basis function is written like this, where DGI is a matrix of the representations and phi G is a basis function included in our role. Notice that we use rows instead of columns precisely to match the group multiplication table properly. So, to quickly summarize what we have covered in this video, we worked with an example of a symmetry group because it's relevant for applications in physics and chemistry, although this is not a necessary restriction in general. Functions, which are good enough, transform into linear combinations of each other under symmetry operations, and these transformations can be described by matrices. Under the transformations of a particular group, functions can behave only in few specific ways, determined by irreducible representations or reps of the group. Although there are infinitely many ways to construct matrices satisfying the group multiplication table, any such representation can always be reduced to block diagonal form by a single change of basis, the same for all group elements. This is not the last video on irreducible representations in physics. Please don't forget to subscribe, not to skip the next one.